But first, we're going to go to a different scene. This was about 10 years prior. It was in Washington, D.C., April 29th, 2008. Some of you already know a little bit about this story. It was in the, as you can tell, cherry blossom. It was beautiful weather in the 60s, high 50s, 60s. It was in the Tony K Street District. You can see it's kind of funny. It's in downtown in a cosmopolitan area. They could clearly afford to build buildings higher than seven stories, but why do they not do that? There's a law there that no building can be higher than the U.S. Capitol, so that's why it's kept that way. What human life form is it infested with?
Scumbag.
Lobbyists. So this is a big lobbyist area. We're joining in the office of a very, very good doctor. He was a doctor to the stars in D.C., doctor to the lobbyists in D.C., because lobbyists tend to have a lot of money. His name is Tim Newman. The patient was 58 years old, or excuse me, 54. I need to get new glasses. I thought it was 58. I'm going to have to look back here. 58 years old, non-smoker, fairly unremarkable family history. Waist was 40 inches. He liked his food. He had to eat out a lot as part of his job. And he was a very social guy. He had high blood pressure. It was controlled on an ACE inhibitor. We might talk later about ACE inhibitors and the fact that the ACE was changed to an ARB, and that actually might have had some impact on what happened later. But we might not. It depends on whether you have interest. I'm on an ACE inhibitor, and this is the first day I've been able to talk without a cough in about 3 weeks. But we'll talk about that later, too. The CRP was unremarkable. It was actually remarkable the fact that Dr. Newman knew in 2008 to get a CRP. Very, very few docs knew that. The cardiovascular risk, event risk estimator, anybody know what that is? Framingham. We'll talk about Framingham. It's not a measurement of plaque, it's a guess, and it's a very bad guess. We'll talk about why. Anyhow, he was worried. He knew that he needed to, he kept saying, Doc, as soon as my job slows down a little bit, I'm going to start losing some weight. That was his mantra. He and Newman had shared that multiple times publicly. And so they said, okay, let's do a stress test. We'll see if you're good. It turned out normal, so he was relieved. He went back to his lifestyle that he came from. And they changed the medicines from the med to from an ACE to an ARB. 6 weeks later, oops, I gave away the story. Well, many of you knew already. 6 weeks later, he's in the bureau recording. We'll get to that in a minute. 6 weeks later, he's at work. He collapses. CPR was done by coworkers. EMS was called at 1:40. They arrived 4 minutes later, so it wasn't because there was a slow EMS. They shocked him three times on the way into the hospital, where he was pronounced dead at Sibley Memorial. Autopsy showed plaque rupture in the left anterior descending artery. And yes, that's who it was. Tim Russert, Big Russ, 1950 to 2008. He was returning from a family vacation in Rome. His son had graduated from some Ivy League school, Boston College, and has had a birthday, so they were celebrating that. He was the host of Meet the Press and flew home to tape some things. He was walking from the sound room to the sound room over to do voiceovers. His last words were, "What's happening?" You know, this was 2008. That was the thing that you said instead of hello. What's happening? He said that to Candace Harrington, the editing supervisor. He'd been host of Meet the Press since 1991. His passion, research, and ability to find clips of inconsistencies. You know, he made fools of, he did his research, and government officials made fools of themselves because they were being inconsistent with what they did, what they said, or what they did years before. and they had to squirm in front of the press and the public, and people loved him for that. But all that was ended when a plaque ruptured in his left anterior descending. Now, why did that happen? Well, the New York Times said, well, his doctors didn't know that he had plaque. You know, that's one of the things we're going to start talking about. How do you know you have plaque? It's pretty important to know, wouldn't you think? I think for most of us in here, we understand. That's, I mean, that's a reason why a whole bunch of us came, so we could get that, CIMT. Well, they did know. They were very clear. He had a positive calcium score 10 years before, score of 210. Doctors Newman and Brin, Newman was his internist, Brin was his cardiologist, they did say, look, the autopsy showed a lot more plaque than we expected because he just had a negative stress test. And given that he passed the negative stress test, we do know that he didn't have a 50% occlusion. But that was over 10 years ago, so things are a lot better now, right? Medicine has moved very quickly. Well, actually, there have been improvements. The heart attack rate, we'll talk about that in just a minute. These guys, the interventional cardiologists, love to give them a hard time, as you know. They've actually done some stuff. There are very few groups of medicine that have actually changed the American life expectancy. They have, by a few months. The public health guys did by decades, but the docs really can't take credit for that. It was the engineers anyway. And anyhow, is that your choice for how you extend your life? It's hard to change your habits, but it's a lot worse going through that. And we've got some folks that could share if that comes up later. So, Wall Street Journal. When did that come out? Does anybody know? 3 months ago? 4 months ago? This was very, very recent. Oops. Speaking of family and your loved ones, this is the family for, I believe his name was Oscar. We'll find it in just a few minutes and we'll see a picture of him. Heart attack at 49. America's biggest killer is making a deadly comeback. We'll look at the numbers. Right there. So, yes, things were getting a lot better. We were actually, can you see that? If you can, I'm going to just, this is a yellow line, and that's the cancer death rate. So we were about to take heart attack off the number one spot for killers until about 10 years ago, about the time that Tim Russert died, that curve started going right back up, and it's still number one. And again, it's happening younger. Well, we'll talk. Oscar died at 49. It's happening. This is Steve Nissen. He's a well-known CIMT researcher. It's happening among younger people, obese people. The obesity epidemic is a major part of that curve going right back up. It's also happening, though, among non-smokers and women. This is a woman that had an obese woman that was struggling and had a heart attack. She's struggling with changing her health habits so she doesn't have another one. This is the CDC getting into detail on where that's happening. It's happening in urban areas. It's happening in small bedroom communities, and as
I think what you've done with this is amazing. I know there's others out there that are teaching and talking about heart attack and stroke prevention, but very few people are really trying to get people in a room, consumers in a room, and do it. So I want to commend you for that. It's a great course. Thanks for allowing me to be part of it and talk a little bit about how dentistry fits in. I really appreciate it. And I really hope people would come and search this out and take this course.